I can't even talk right now. I fucking hate those people. Anyhow, Just Frank's coming up. Give a round of applause. It's Just motherfucking Frank. Let's go. All right, keep it going there for Charles. All right, we've got a good crowd here tonight. I am Just Frank, and I want to welcome all of you to Scotch 2. Thank you for coming out to support live comedy. Give yourselves a round of applause. So for those of you that haven't seen me before, this is what I look like.
Just Frank, right.
And so, I don't have a lot of profanity in my set, so I want to apologize for that right up front. But enough about me for right now. Let me dip out into the audience. Do we have any anniversaries in the house? Anniversaries? Anybody, okay. Anybody on their second and third marriages? That happens, it happens. Any newlyweds? A group back in the back there? Yeah, it's good to get those first marriages out of the way. How about any birthdays? People have any birthdays?
I have a birthday.
This week? Okay. I know better than to ask you how old. We'll just wish you a happy birthday there, though.
Thank you, darling.
Okay. I used to have birthdays, but I had to give them up. I turned 39 back in August several years ago. And that's been working out pretty well for me, so I'm going to be 39 for a while to come. So you know, when we got this show set up, we tried to get Leonard Skinner to come out here and open up for us. And of course, they declined. Then we tried to get Maroon 5, and they declined. But you might be in for a treat tonight, ladies and gentlemen. On this stage, how would you all like to see the Bare Naked Ladies tonight? So would I. Ladies, any volunteers? So I was in the Army for a while, and one of the places I was stationed at was Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. Anybody been there? Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri? Is also known as Fort Lost in the Woods. It's a very rural place, probably the way Charles County was about 40 years ago. Very rural. And they have a unique highway system there. They don't name the roads after the founders of the community. They name them after, like, they have A Highway, B Highway, and C Highway. True story. And that worked out pretty well for the first 26 roads. Then they had to get creative, so they came up with AA Highway, AB Highway, AC Highway. So you know, when I was in rural Missouri, and this was several years ago, I went into a restroom, male's restroom, and it's the first time I ever saw a baby changing station in the men's room. And I thought, wow, for rural Missouri, this is pretty progressive. And I looked around the room, and I saw an oversized stall. And because nobody was in there, I took a peek inside and saw a little jump seat in there for a toddler, you know? Now I'm thinking to myself, in rural Missouri, where you have these 250-pound cornbread-fed, beer-drinking, pickled pigs feed-eating guys, the conversation had to go like this. All right, you hold on there, Junior, because Daddy's got to do some business. But before I do, I'm going to strap you down, because this might be a rough ride. I think if you're going to put a kid in those kind of hazardous conditions, you should have an oxygen mask coming down from the ceiling for the little guy. So when I was in the Army, we had some raggedy equipment initially. We had helmets, steel pot helmets, flak jackets, pistol belts, you know, stuff left over from wars past. And eventually we got upgraded. We had Kevlar helmets, Kevlar flak jackets, elbow pads, knee pads, maxi pads. You know, for those heavy days. So anyway, I watch a lot of television, and I'm kind of amazed at some of the infomercials that you see late at night. They have, and you might have seen it, an infomercial about ITC, Institute of Technical Careers. And apparently, after just 4 weeks, I could become a locksmith. But the one that caught my interest most was animal anesthesiologist. Now, you know what an anesthesiologist is? That's the guy who puts you to sleep, you know, before an operation or some kind of medical procedure. So that's what caught my eye. I sent away for the course, and they sent me back to course. And so as I was interviewed, or as I was going through it the next day, come to find out they only sent me half of the course. So I completed it, sent it back to them, expecting to get the other half of the correspondence course. And instead, what I got was a certificate of diploma, certificate of completion, and a diploma. So I went out and got me a job as an animal anesthesiologist. And I mean, I was halfway good at it. I could put the animals to sleep okay, but waking them up was a little bit harder. Yeah, so, now I went to visit my brother the other day. He lives over here in Charles County. And he married his high school sweetheart. They've been married a long time now. And I'm divorced myself, but whenever, and I don't see my brother too often, but when I go over there and see him and his wife, it reminds me of when I was in high school and the first love that I had, you know, first romantic encounter. I think back to a time of innocence. You know, I was 17, she was 17, it was my first time. It was her 21st time, because, you know, girls mature faster than boys. But after, just like anybody else in high school, after about a month, we decided to go our separate ways. And the reason being is we decided we didn't have enough in common. And our friend said, well, you gotta work at a relationship. You should work at having things in common. And I suppose that's true. We could have worked at it until we had two or three kids in common, a mortgage in common, and divorce lawyers in common. But instead, we decided to go our separate ways. Ah, yeah, that's just the way I feel. So we decided to go our separate ways because we didn't have enough in common. And even if you do have things in common with your significant other, it's not always going to work. For example, if you meet, or if you met your high school sweetheart, and you both wear the same kind of clothes, listen to the same kind of music, and have the same friends, and one of you is a teacher, and one of you is a student, it's probably not going to work. If you go to a social hall, and you strike up a conversation with somebody who's pretty attractive, and you find out that your backgrounds are very similar, and the sign in the social hall says, "Welcome to rehab," it's probably not going to work. Some people turn to astrology to find their compatible mate. And I find that that only works about half the time, personally, because, for example, I'm a Leo, so I'm outgoing. My girlfriend, she's bipolar. So we only get along half the time. When we get along, it's really great. You know, the sex is great. The jokes are great. We enjoy doing things together, but sometimes, and I don't know if it's the bipolarism or the PMSism, if those are even words, but when that rolls around, then there's nothing you can do that's right, you know? No matter what you say, it's wrong. And sometimes you go on like a little tangent and start rolling on about, well, you don't listen to me. And she always starts on off, well, she starts off a conversation with, we need to talk. We need to talk.
That what?
Now, when she says we need to talk, it's never we need to talk, I'm pretty horny, but I'm going to get back there and get busy. It's always we need to talk, do you want to be in this relationship? And then, now this is where it gets tricky, it's almost like Jeopardy, because she'll ask a question, but then she will jump right in and answer the question too. Do you want to be in this relationship? No, I don't think you do. Because if you did, then you would buy me flowers, and you'd take me out to eat, and you would listen to me when I talk, and you would, you know, communicate better with me. But do you do those things? No. So she goes on and on and on. I can't get a word in edgewise. So I've developed a new strategy. The next time she says, we need to talk, what I'm going to say, if I want to shut her down, I'm going to say, you know, the doctor called today, and he said, you only have a week to live. A little bit too harsh? Okay, maybe I'll say, the doctor called today, and he says you have a very strange case of laryngitis. Maybe you shouldn't talk for a week or two. So, anyway, people are out there trying to have relationships. Everybody who's in a relationship, give yourself a round of applause. All right. It's good. It's hard to be in a relationship, but it's well worth it. All right, single folks out there, by round of applause, we got any single folks out there? By round of applause. Yeah, single folks, they're all excited. They know how to work those hands. So anyway, excuse me. Yeah, yeah.
Let's go.
One more time?
One more time, let's get busy.
All right, get busy. You're not horny, are you?
Not telling any.
You know, I don't know if any of you went out on the deck earlier. They had a ornament of some sort hanging up over there. Now, I know what the custom is if you happen to be underneath the mistletoe. I don't know what the custom is if you happen to be under a 2-foot-long dildo.
Duck.
Duck, yes, that is very good advice. So let me get a drink of water here. Y'all take a drink. Y'all thirsty? All right, drink up, drink up. So, you know, being in a relationship is kind of hard. And early on, it's pretty nice. People got pet names for each other. You might have pet names for your significant other, such as, you know, Honeybun, Sugar Pie, Godzilla, Orko. So, what is that? Some people have pet names for their private parts. Anybody got any pet names for their private parts that they want to share? Stable Stan.
Justin.
What?
Ouch.
Ouch. That's a good one, yeah. My girlfriend has a cute name for her private parts. She calls it Hodina. And I gotta tell you, Hodina is a cute sounding name. I love Hodina. I love the name Hodina, and I love Hodina itself, too. And, you know, sometimes when my girlfriend's fast asleep, and I'm not because I'm a little stressed out, I'll go and visit Bodina, you know, just to knock the stress off. And, because men know that sex will take care of stress. Isn't that right, man? Help me out. Right? It helps to de-stress you. It de-escalates the situation. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but sex will also help to alleviate some other minor problems in your life, too, such as cuts and bruises, appendicitis. You know, what's the remedy for that? Sex, right? Sex will take care of appendicitis, leprosy, you know. So anyway, if women get stressed out or they get injured, they tend to see a physician or go to comfort food, but mostly comfort food. So I thought I'd help my girlfriend out. She's got a stressful job. And when she came home from work, I said, come here, baby. Look like you had a hard day at work. Help yourself with some Häagen-Dazs. All the protein you need without the calories.
Oh,
All right, get it out the system. Any alibis out there? All right, but men and women see things differently. For example, men look at a relationship like it's a vacation. That's our ideal relationship. You know, you come home from work, and and women, on the other hand, they take the relationship very seriously. It's work to them. It's something that's got to work, you know. There's no turning back. Men make no mistake about this. Women are the undercover boss. They are expecting you to perform, and they will reward you accordingly. So you need to help them out if you can. Now, some people, well, let's see, I go back to, any bathroom connoisseurs in here? Bathroom connoisseurs, one back there. Connoisseur means, you know, like sample a lot of different things. Anyway, so I'm back in the dating pool because of the Podina thing and the Haagen-Dazs thing. And I noticed that women are interested in two things, basically. They're interested in looking good, and they are looking good. They're working out, they're running, jogging, jumping around, looking pretty good. And the other thing that concerns women, though, are the public restrooms, mostly like in gas stations or restaurants, you know, the cleanliness of it. Sometimes that can be a problem for women. Now, if it's not a problem, and if you travel with women, you know, women come out and they're all excited if they have a good experience. They'll say things like, you know, they have perfume soaps, oversized stalls, soft music. I give them a 10, you know. I would go back there in a minute. But other times when the restroom experience is not that good, then women have two choices, and hold it or hover. That's how they build up those leg muscles there. And you know what I'm talking about, hovering. So I think that business people everywhere should upgrade their facilities, but if they can't afford to do that, then what they ought to do is rip out the commode in the women's room, just leave a hole there in the middle of the floor, and install some gymnastic rings and parallel bars. And this way, a woman's physical fitness needs and hygienic needs can be taken care of at the same time. Yeah. Now, you know, a point of contention between men and women is sometimes the bathroom seat, the position, whether it's up or down. Now, men go in the bathroom basically to shit, shower, and shave. We go in there, we do our business, and we leave the seat up most of the time, not to be mean or inconsiderate, but we leave it up because we know the next time we're going in there, we're probably going to do number one as opposed to number two, and so it's ready for us. Now, women, on the other hand, they got a whole lot of things going on in the bathroom. They got to put their makeup on, fix their hair. They're thinking about what they got to cook for dinner, who's going to take care of the kids, dropping people off, who they're going to be mad at work, why they're going to be mad at you when they see you again, what outfit to wear, and what shoes are going to go with that outfit. So to women, a bathroom is not just a bathroom, it's a command and control center. And occasionally, if they sit down and they read 50 Shades of Grey, it becomes an entertainment center too. So in short, women got 99 things to do in the bathroom, and putting down the toilet seat ain't one of them. So anyway, men just trying to be a little bit courteous about that. Now, I'd like to talk a little bit about the economy. The economy's kind of tanked, it's gone down, and people have taken up bartering. Now, bartering is the exchange of goods and services that mutually benefit both parties. For example, I'm a mechanic and you're a painter, so I'm going to say, I'll fix your car, and you paint the exterior of my house. Both parties mutually benefit from that. Now, ladies, what I would say is, make up a list. If you got things you want your husband to do, you know, make up a list and exchange with them. Say, hey, honey, you fix that kitchen door, then I'll bake your favorite apple pie. And leave the toilet seat down for a week, you get 15 minutes ahead. Now, I'd like to say, almost in the words of almost just like Sally Struthers, and hopefully you know who she is, based on a 5-day work week. You know, that only equates to 3 minutes a day, ladies. Surely you can afford 3 minutes a day to have the toilet seat down all the time. So think about it. So anyway, do y'all want to hear a joke or two? All right. Have you heard, now stop me if you heard this before. You heard the pancake joke? All right. Well, there's these two brothers, and being raised by a single mom. And the single mom was doing the best she could to raise them up, be good Christian people, unlike some people. Anyway, she cooked a pancake and put it on the table, and the boys started fighting over it. Her two boys were probably about 8, 9 years old, pretty close in age there. And so she looked over them and said, hey, now, you have to think about this. There's one pancake, there's two of you. What would Jesus do in a situation like this? Well, the boys looked at each other. They looked at their mom. They didn't know. And they said, well, we don't know. And so she said, well, I'll tell you what Jesus would do. He would say, here, brother, you take the first pancake. You know, I'll wait for the next one. And with that, the older boy looked at the younger boy and said, guess what? You get to be Jesus today. Now, have you heard Right in the Groove? There's a young guy goes into a restaurant, got a little bit of an attitude, he's kind of cocky, and he says, hey, waiter, come here. And it's kind of a little bit rude. He says, waiter, come here. You go back there and you tell a damn cook I want a cheeseburger. Not too greasy, not too dry, but right in the groove. And you go back there and you tell that cook that I want some damn fries. Not too soggy, not too crisp. Right in the groove. And so the waiter says, okay, will there be anything else? And the guy says, yeah, you go back there and you tell the damn cook that I want a milkshake, not too thick, not too thin, but right in the groove. So the waiter goes into the kitchen, he talks to the cook, and he comes back out in about 5 minutes, and he says, the cook says you can kiss his ass, not on the left cheek, not on the right cheek. Right in the groove. All right, now, do we have any Cajuns in the audience? Cajuns. Here's a good Cajun joke. I like this joke. There's two Cajuns, middle-aged couple, John Paul and Matilda. And they're at that age where they're not really paying too much attention to each other. So anyway, John Paul sitting there reading the paper at breakfast in the morning, and Matilda says, you know, John Paul, I went to the doctor for an examination yesterday, and that doctor's had me take off all my clothes. And John Paul just goes, And she says, you know, John Paul, that doctor say for a woman my age, I got the nicest breast he ever did see. And John Paul goes, And then John Paul says, what'd that doctor say about the big ass you got? And she said, well, you know, during the whole examination, that doctor never bring up a name once. All right. I think I got one more for you. This is a Christmas joke. I know it's not Christmas, but it's a good joke anyway. So anyway, there was this young couple that's married. They have a kid, little girl, about 4 or 5 years old. And the dad goes to the little girl and says, what do you want for Christmas this year? And the little girl says, well, I think I want a baby brother. So the dad scratches his head and says, oh, I don't know about that. I'm going to have to talk to mommy. So 9 months goes by, and she gets a baby brother. And a couple more months go by, and it's Christmas again. So the dad says to the little girl, what do you want for Christmas this year? And the little girl says, well, if it's not too much trouble for mommy, I think I want a pony. All right. Well, thank you very much. That's my time. I hope you all enjoyed the show. And do well. Be good to each other and be good to yourselves. All right. All right. All right. All right. Do this.